Yeah, thanks a lot, Warren, for the invitation again. I'll try and be real. And thanks to the organizers, to Jord, for everything. And yeah, and thanks to you for hanging in this far in the day. I've prepared a fragment that I'll be reading. And like John, I'll be staying in the shadows and I'll be trailing the after effects of psychedelic experience, trailing the after effects of the trip and the artistic practices that have dealt with it. So the following is an attempt at extending or displacing art's psychedelic connection into the present. I'll do so by way of a perhaps counterintuitive argument. Counterintuitive because it would be anti-psychedelic to work with the grain and fulfill expectations. We should expect to be carried away, or we should at least expect movement. So I'll propose to talk about art's psychedelic connection in terms of a certain event format, if you will, namely the ephemeral and the molecular, or that which is literally subversive because it's too small to be held by, to be possessed by ego, or to be held by perception. And this will describe a departure from what Robert Masters and Gene Houston in 1968 defined, Masters and Houston defined a psychedelic art as too much, quite simply. Psychedelic art is, it's too much, they said. And by this they outlined an aesthetic of mimetic overload, a visual orgy, the unlimited convertibility of form. So how can you constitute the concept of the psychedelic today in relation to the intuitions and politics it assumes and that it has brought along with it from the 20th century? How may it still make sense to apply to recent artistic practices? It must be an elementary way to resist cognitive capitalism and a psychotic experience economy, to insist on thinking long and hard about a subject and to try to articulate this act of contemplation. This would touch on the non-habitual perceptual act and how all artworks begin to move under patient contemplation, as Adorno put it. When you meditate on an artwork until it falls into bits and pieces and the experience must be stitched back together with words. To me, there's something in art psychedelic connection that epitomizes the aesthetic experience's displacement of presence and categorical stability. In a psychedelic contact consciousness with what is outside and non-self, this difference can be seen to appear in terms of dissolution, diminution, becoming smaller, becoming imperceptible, a subtractive protocol turned towards emergence and becoming. Henriette Heise, a Danish artist, writes about her darkness machines. A darkness machine is stitched together from circles of blackout fabric. If you leave one on a green lawn, it will kill every plant beneath it. The darkness produced is the sort that simultaneously attracts and scares us, sex and death, unquote. Heise's practice doesn't have a connection to drug culture. It's my postulate that there is a connection to psychedelia or psychedelic tropes and concepts. But I think it overlaps with the particular sense of abstraction that belongs to much art created in relation to psychedelia, an emphasis on process and imagination rather than finished object or coherent image. If you place one of Heise's darkness machines in front of a light source, lines of light appear in stitch holes in the fabric as microscopic vistas to the other side, or as so many vanishing points of reality principles we'll have to let go of. Facing Heise's abstract machines that undo representation, the beholder is awash with flows of tiny data. To think art's psychedelic connection in terms of becoming smaller would be an acid aesthetic in the literal sense of the term. A dissolution as when you dissolve parliament and dismiss a legislature, or dissolution as in decadence, to recall a symbolist genealogy. It is a diminuendo, which according to the dictionary is the musical term for a passage that is to be played gradually or more softly. This would describe the substance, this would describe the substanceless lightness of the LSD trip, or how psilocybin hilariously will turn you into a jelly of wiggly mushroom spores. But can it also be a poetics of the invasive physical rage of ayahuasca? Or that was my ayahuasca trip, at least. I take it for granted that we know the effects of drugs, but also that we must undo narco-essentialism to reach the art. The stock reference here is Baudelaire, who famously wrote that one should always be drunk, that's all that matters. That's our one imperative need. Get drunk and never pause for rest, with wine, poetry, or with virtue, you must, as you choose. Or in the paradoxical and radical words of the mesque head Henri Michaud, les drogues nous ennuient, the drugs bore us. Which I understand as a way of saying simply that drugs is just one cultural technology among others, but also to say that I think of psychedelia in terms of materialistic acid. Its condition of possibility is its historical context and the symbolic orders into which it is inscribed. And one must work with the psychedelic from the ground up, or from the ground down, as it were, in a demolition of objects and certainties to ever smaller parts. Henri Michaud seismically rendered the nervous fever caused by mescaline highs that earns him recognition as a psychedelic pioneer, even before the term was coined. Michaud emphasized how the only real pleasure takes place in relation to an other. To enjoy a drug, one must enjoy being a subject, he wrote, which must mean that pleasure is a very ambiguous thing. Michaud was an exemplary bad artist, you could say, one of those who submits himself to art, who eats art, so to speak, to self-transform. There is neither origin nor homecoming in his works, only becoming, in other words, that which is created or produced in all its contingency and with all its accidents, and that becomes the origin of the next movement. To talk about art's psychedelic connection today, we must necessarily divorce it from 60s counterculture. It is an artistic relation that is homeless, devoid of an origin, and no less full of politics for it. This is why I talk about art's psychedelic connection rather than psychedelic art, which to me denotes the visual face of the counterculture with its acid rock posters and communal murals. We know how the trip became an image, a genre, a hook that ensured its return and its re-returns to the self-same. To mention some of its sins, a good part of the psychedelic imaginary was often unself-reflexively white, nationalist, male, straight, commercial, heteronormative, romanticist, etc., not to mention hostile to the art concept. It is significant that artists were wary of the term psychedelic already in the 1960s because of the way it had become a magic sales word. Call it psychedelic and it will sell fast, a headline in the Wall Street Journal ran in 1967. So on the eve of the summer of love, psychedelic styles spread through the mainstream as fast as any capitalist rash. The market push was on through Hollywood's psychedelic epics and the canonization of an LSD art in mainstream magazines. The artist Woody Wasolka dispatches the aesthetic demon of a psychedelic style with his observation that the West Coast poster gave the trip a handle. With day-glow colors and floppy lettering, it ghettoized otherness and made immediacy marketable. So the concept of the psychedelic can be totalizing, perhaps even imperialist. Elio Aitisica, the Brazilian artist, broke it down with this neologism of the suprasensorial, or suprasensorial, I guess, would be, that'd be correct, yeah, thank you. As an alternative to what he saw as the messianic example of Timothy Leary and his followers in the US, as Ochishika wrote. That is, with this, Ochishika proposed a geopolitical analysis and cultural translation of the psychedelic that ensured it an arrival to the global south to a Brazilian context. That is a process of artistic mediation. The drug is the mediation of the immediate, to quote Wilhelm Flusser from his wonderfully titled essay, again in Portuguese, Nossa Embriaguez, or in English, Our Drunkenness. The mediation of the immediate. How do you stage and dramatize such ambivalence in art? Maybe through a kind of nano-sensualism that looks to the zero degree of the event. What it might feel like to be hit by one proton at a time, as the artist Søren Andreasen puts it. Such a modest characterization of the extreme bullet time of the psychedelic experience makes it clear that the cliches of expansion were never very helpful. Andreasen proposes a different poetics, another imagination, that of a skeptical and self-skeptical sensuousness. His work offers a kind of post-phenomenological critique of representation that takes its point of departure in an unwillingness or an incapacity to see the whole before the parts. Here the parts are not subjugated to a superstructure or contained within a framework. Accordingly, Andreasen proposes that his graphic fragments are to be seen as neural wormholes in time and space, as he puts it, that may connect us to a pre- or post-human experience of formlessness. This is what Warren talked about as well in his presentation. This is the imperceptible level of reality that the human nervous system translates into comprehensible messages and information, a process of translation, however, that also prevents us from experiencing something else than the human-made world. In his nomic graphics, Andreasen depicts embryonic, almost formed entities that evoke the non-human strata of plasma and molecules. Or as in the series Pseudotronics, he attempts to render light effects by the anachronistic means of woodcutting, as a counter move to a screen world where all images are already moving. Andreasen offers non-moving images for contemplation. So these old school graphic techniques offer a method for calling up absence. Sorry. The graphic process enables the artist to make an image by removing material rather than adding it, and by printing with a negative form that which is no longer or not yet there. Often the results of automatic or machining procedures, Andreasen's lino cuts and woodcuts acknowledge the subversive micro level that we cannot pick up on the narrow band of human perception. What it might feel like to be hit by one proton at a time. In turbulent systems, the single particle is a microscopic figure of order that corresponds to macroscopic chaos. As an observer of turbulence in financial markets puts it, quote, the ideal case scenario that we could know and comprehend the movement of each individual particle in turbulent motion quickly proves illusory. Even though modern computers might be capable of storing so much data, it is doubtful whether such an exercise would provide us with any worthwhile knowledge, unquote. I'm quoting an article by an economist called Joachim Peinke, an article called Turbulenzen am Finanzmarkt. For our purposes, we can observe that psychedelia is nothing if not a limit figure of knowledge and representation. A shared root of psychedelia and cognitive capitalism is that of cybernetics. Andrew Pickering defines cybernetics as an ontology of unknowability. The domain of all possible machines, cybernetics understood the brain as an opaque, performative, and replicable organ, not a thinker analyzing abstract science. In the end, the cybernetic assumption of a parallelism between electronic circuit and nervous system proved to be untenable or merely metaphoric. as Warren also mentioned, they're events that cannot be erased from the nervous system, but will leave their imprint and their impact. And obviously, the contemporary human nervous system is the site of the effects, anxiety, trauma, overloading, disconnection of a cognitive capitalism that is half-brained and Pavlovian and despotic rather than properly cognitive. In the Otterleith Group's film Anathema from 2011, we are presented with a vertiginous zoom into the material substrate of image-born capitalism. It's a perfect imaging of the trip as a digital psychedelic dream time, you could say, as movement without progression. In their film, advanced information technology has come alive and capital has turned into a sentient entity that probes human life and human bodies. The film consists of manipulated television commercials for various touchscreen technologies, such as mobile phones, flat-screen televisions. In the making of the film, the artists Angelica Sagar and Koju Eshun have used a type of software that enabled them to break down the representational image and travel from image level of the commercials to the abstract level of pixel and code. So the film describes, from the beginning of the film to the end of the film, it describes a kind of, you know, a travel from the representational level, the appropriated TV commercials, to the abstract level of pixels. So it ends up with these beautiful abstract pixel landscapes towards the end. From a historical point of view, the film shows what has happened to the plasmatic vistas of the psychedelic image. With touchscreen LCD systems, LCD is an acronym of liquid crystal display, what once provided an effective and open-ended countercultural environment has become the material substrate of image-born capital. Like Florencia, I will quote Mark Fisher, who writes about Anathema, that it, quote, demonstrates the liquid erotic lure of communicative capitalist tactility. Anathema asks what would happen if the promises made by capital actually came true. The film's conjecture is that we would be in the very libidinal dreaming space which capital cannot but rely on, even as it continually inhibits us from attaining it. The nervous system displaces the Cartesian echoes of the brain. The nervous system is not the idea of the singular, the center, but of the multiple of networks through which we exist in irritated interdependence with culture at large. Deleuze and Guattari advise us in A Thousand Plateaus that the multiple must be made. The multiple must be made in the simplest of ways. The only way the one belongs to the multiple, always subtracted. Subtract the unique from the multiplicity to be constituted right at n minus one dimensions, unquote. So you must refrain from adding what Deleuze and Guattari call the higher dimensions. The higher dimensions of the psychedelic imaginary would perhaps be notions of equilibrium, a metaphysics of love, transcendentalism, as we heard in John's lecture, holism, yes, perhaps even freedom, all the big promises of the psychedelic imaginary. Because who's to say that you won't end up like Bernward Vesper while you're on the trip? As he observes at one point in his unfinished fragment novel, Die Reise, The Journey or The Trip, that was posthumously published in 1977, quote, he writes about being on a trip, and he writes at one point, quote, here my forces left me and everything collapsed in itself, and I sat once more in my pot of piss, unquote. If art's relation to the psychedelic seems immunized against a conventional art history based on nation and media, canon, genius, one cannot in fact be sure that it will continue to actively overstep the threshold of the majoritarian standard, the way Deleuze and Guattari define a minor history. As I've mentioned, history shows how the psychedelic didn't simply stay a minoritarian form of expression, but in spite of all the social and legal prohibitions against it, quickly turned into a super form. You could see its style dovetail with the morphology of capital itself, even. If you think of Marx's analysis of the constant continuity of the process of capital, what he called, quote, its fluid transition of value from one form into another, unquote. In other words, considering its mainstream presence since the 60s and 70s, the psychedelic is not necessarily or not only an underdog in Western culture, but a changeling, a shapeshifter, a differential of value. So ours is a time, today is a time when psychedelia has in a sense been realized. It's how we are socialized, you could say. We've talked about a lot already today. To give you another example, this is also how the labor market operates, for instance. In the words of Josef Vogel, writing in his wonderful book, The Specter of Capital from 2010, quote, having once been instructed to grasp their journey through life as a process of self-becoming, those who try to succeed in the job market are now urged to cultivate the art of becoming other, unquote, which is a very psychedelic idea, this becoming other. So in an age of rampant market conformability in relation to the totality of individual practices and movements, it must be acknowledged how an aspect of psychedelia has become conventional. Also for this reason, we must keep its radical ambiguity going as its capacity for providing us with ideas of how reality is programmed and the possible countermoves we can make. With this in mind, we can go sub-sensorial, to use the Finnish artist Pierre Lindman's homegrown term that displaces Ilioi Tissika's notion of the suprasensorial. Her work for Incerteza Viva, last year's Sao Paulo Biennial, was called Nose, Ears, Eyes, and was an eco-feminist or soma aesthetic project, if you will, with which or into which we can extend art's psychedelic connections. It was a project that addressed the human body and its surroundings through concepts of membranes, nervous systems, and atmospheres. Lindman writes in the context of Nose, Ears, Eyes, skin is the primary organ through which we communicate with our surroundings. We feel, we breathe, move in, and with the skin. Skin touching another skin releases oxytocin, a hormone that, when released, produces well-being. Oxytocin is understood to be essential in social bonding and the creation of trust. Central nervous systems of living organisms begin with the folding of the neural plate into a tube. The same neural plate also develops into sensors and skin. Fascinatingly, skin, the membrane of the cell, folding onto itself and becoming a tube is the beginning of the complex system of sensors and signals. Further, the microbiome on a person suggests a topography of the skin. Microbes dwell in the nooks and crannies of our body, and the skin mediates their possible passage in and out of our bodies. What is our immediate body sphere like? What does it depend upon? And how can we devise it to deepen our dialogue with our surroundings? Unquote. So Lindman's work is a concern with life in the folds, to quote Henri Michaud, which is a book of Michaud's, Life in the Folds, La Vie dans le Pli. But in Lindman's work, it has a therapeutic dimension as well. Nose, Ears, Eyes was informed by Lindman's research in the Kalevala, which is a Finnish epic that united ancient songs, narratives, and popular myths. the Kalevala was compiled and written down in the 19th century by a Swedish historian. The medical part of this oral and musical tradition, which is still in the process of being recorded, consists of knowledges based on the centuries-old life practices of agrarian communities, including anatomical studies and different healing practices. So the main activity in those CSIs revolved around Kalevala bone alignment therapy, which is a type of massage or osteopathy focused on the joints and the bones that Lindman has learned to give. Her project went beyond the sort of the treatment of the individual body, however. She designed this mud hut inside the biennial pavilion, which was built with materials such as cane, straw, clay, to create an environment where she was present throughout the exhibition period to offer treatment to biennial visitors. With tentacles and sensory organs, the mud hut reached across the interior of the pavilion and out through its windows to the Ibirapuera Park outside in order to allow for the real and imagined circulation of air and other material data between different spaces. The production of drawings with ink and oil pastels was part of the work, sometimes in collaboration with her clients. The resulting images and diagrams represent a process of attunement to energy flows, halos, movements, and blockages of energy as Lindman sees them or picks them up during the treatment. Nosier's eyes exceeded Lindman as a healer by way of expanding agency to include non-human agents at a bacterial level, whether they are invasive toxins and pollutants, or all the microorganisms that help our bodies to function normally. The human body's affective and somatic relations are addressed, or were addressed in her work, beyond its perceptual capabilities, and the self is seen as an ecology that is already inscribed in other systems than itself. In this way, Lindman's project outlined the possibility of reconnecting psychedelic tropes and concepts, you could say, to indigenous knowledge forms by way of hooking up nervous systems and different historical trajectories and by using the body as an instrument, as a political instrument, perhaps. Yeah, by way of conclusion, you could say that art's psychedelic relation takes the nervous system as its site of production to develop a critique of experience. This relation can be understood as dynamic arrangements that connect the somatic with the symbolic and create effects in and across perceptual and representational systems that undo what we are and how we understand that which we endure. We can place our hope in the effects as unruly and fugitive remainders. When the event-shaping properties of drugs and technologies take the stage, effects come out to play and work. Effects that displace the actual present into the virtual, pushing at the not yet realized while they loop, sound, and flicker in a kind of fermenting time. As forces external to intentionality and control, the power of effects and the power of the effects of effects, as per John's presentation, the power of effects consists in their childlike disobedience. They are what cannot be created or produced, but can only be caused to be, and therefore they are capable of getting away. In this way, sensation and cognition no longer belong only to human subjects, but somehow to the effects themselves, to the events they catalyze and the stimuli they produce. The effect is something as strange as an autonomous supplement. Even if it is derived and secondary, it takes on a life of its own in which dreams untouched by the human brain subsist. Thank you.